night we will be doing drum circle worship again, and all are welcome to that. Welcome. Welcome if you're joining us in person or at home. Welcome if you're here every week or some weeks or just today. We are blessed to be together. Just about a week and a half ago, Canada lost a great storyteller. The world lost a great storyteller with the death of Stuart MacLean. For those of you who listened to Stuart MacLean or read his work, he had an amazing way of touching everyday life and finding the depth that lies underneath, often bringing laughter, deeply moving moments, and tears all in one sentence sometimes. There's a quote from Stuart MacLean that has been played a couple times, that he loved to bring people to that point of laughter and where laughter. There we go. He liked to bring people to the point where laughter and tears met. That's a holy place where the depth of life is experienced. We come together in church to be in community, to journey in life together. And here is a place where the joys of life and the pain of life are all held in a deeply sacred love experienced in community. Today we're celebrating. We've got a baptism. It's a wonderful day. In our tradition, we baptize people to remind them of the love of Christ, the love of God, that they are beloved children of God. We baptize infants in our tradition as a reminder that life has those sacred moments, and we look for those rituals that touch upon the holiness of life, of new birth, of new relationships, of the end of life. All throughout life, we find ways to mark that our life is holy. All of our experiences in life are held in deeply sacred life, love. Today, we'll also be taking part in an ancient ritual of our faith, the marking of ashes. It's also a reminder that all moments of our life are held in the deep sacredness of love and the love of community. So welcome to worship. And if you look in your bulletin, you'll see our announcements for today. Some sad news. Murray Twombly died this past week. We celebrated his life yesterday, and what a life he had. But our thoughts and our prayers are with his wife, Elizabeth, and with the Twombly family. On Friday, March 3rd, that's this Friday, there will be a World Day of Prayer service at the Salvation Army Church at 2 p.m. It's always a wonderful service, so if you're able to make it out, please do. We need some readers from Grace. If you are able to read, please contact Willie, and her contact information is in the bulletin. Also, please note that we keep in our thoughts and prayers a Mountain View United Church in St. Catharines, part of our Hamilton Conference prayer circle. Also, if you look in your pews, there is something new, either this week or last week. There are prayer request cards, and those are for our prayer group. Our prayer group would love to pray with you in your joys, your prayers of thanksgiving, or your prayers of need. So if you feel moved, you can write a prayer of thanksgiving or a prayer of need on your card, and there's a little box at the back there. Also, please note that Messy Church is tonight. Sonia, did you want to mention about Messy Church? Or I invite Sonia up to tell us about Messy Church, which I'm looking very much forward to.
So tonight at 4:30, we're going to celebrate Messy Church. This is an alternative worship opportunity for all ages. So I invite you all to come out. We're going to start with a very short worship time, which is actually a godly play storytelling, which is very nice. And then we're going to join together in a potluck dinner. You can just bring something very simple. And then we have five different activity stations, all based on the creation theme. And You can spend time at one station, or you can move through all five, and just get your hands into some creative practices to reflect on that theme of creation. And we'll be done by 6:30. So we invite everybody to come and join with us for our first of many messy churches. Thank you.
Just a little reminder that this Thursday we will be having walk and talk. So come out and join us for our our walk that we have been getting used to having. It's been great to be out in the fresh air, and last week was a beautiful sunny day, or 2 weeks ago. Another thing, I would just want to say thank you to everyone who took part in the Won't You Be My Valentine. I know there were many smiles on many faces, and both from those who participated and who were recipients of the Valentine. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Are there any other celebrations, sorrows, or announcements people would like to share? In my family, there is a celebration. My sister-in-law last weekend got engaged. So we are very happy for Julia and Sean as they enter into a new place in their relationship together. I invite us to join together in our centering prayer found in the bulletin and on the screen. A vision on a mountaintop as Jesus, Moses, and Elijah appear. The disciples reawaken to the holy. The baptism of a child, and each new life that enters the world. Moments to ponder the sacredness of being. The rising of the sun and the burning bird's songs. Reminders of creation. The embrace of a friend. The comfort of community. In each moment, God's presence is known and life is blessed. And together we pray. O Creator, with the blessing of this new day, open us to your presence and to the blessings that surround us. Strengthen us that we may dare to enter the fullness of life and trust in the embrace of holy love. Amen. And let us join singing, This Is the Day, as we celebrate a new day and a chance to be together.
Thank you.
chain of hands and hugs and nods of affection, we welcome and celebrate one another, greeting each other with the words, "Peace be with you. Peace be with you."
Yeah.
sacrament of baptism. So invite Lori.
Oh, she's already up here. Good.
The sacrament of baptism proclaims and celebrates the grace of God. By water and the Spirit, we are called, claimed, and commissioned. We are called God's own, welcomed as children and beloved of God. We are claimed by Christ, united with one another, and the Christian community of all time and all place, of all life on earth that is fed by sacred water. We are commissioned to Christ's ministry of love, peace, and justice making, and strengthened by the Holy Spirit for the work of the church in the world. Today, we celebrate the sacrament of baptism.
On behalf of the Congregation of Grace United Church, I present Emerson Ann Margaret House for initiation into the body of Christ through baptism.
We have some special music as the family comes up.
Invite the congregation to rise in body or spirit.
Jesus calls us to share our faith with all and to proclaim God's gift of grace through baptism. Do you who witness and celebrate this sacrament promise your love, support, and care to this child who is about to be baptized as she lives and grows in Christ? So please say, we do, by the grace of God.
We do, by the grace of God.
And let's join in singing the new creed, which we found page 918 of Voice Native 4 on the screen. We are not alone.
We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is created.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give our thanks and praise to God.
It is good to give God thanks and praise.
Gracious and holy God, we bless you for the gift of life, and within it the gift of water. Over its unshaped promise, your Spirit hovered in creation. By water comes the growth of the earth. Through water you led the children of Israel to freedom. In the waters of the Jordan, your child Jesus was baptized. Now may your Spirit be upon us in what we do, that this water may be a sign for all of new life in Christ, name we pray. Amen. Invite the congregation to rise their hands in sign of love and blessing. Emerson, may the Holy Spirit guide you, inspire you, and work within you all the days of your life. May you always know that you are blessed to be a blessing. Amen. Baptismal candle signifies the presence of Christ. It is a reminder of the fullness of life that Christ offers all of us. It is a reminder of Jesus telling his disciples they are light of the world. Emerson, may your light shine brightly, that all may see your good works and give glory to God. May you always know you are blessed. We also present you with a prayer shawl. May you know that you are held in God's love, the love of family, and the love of community. Into the name of Jesus Christ, Emerson and Margaret Howes, Emmy, has been received into the Holy Catholic Church, the universal body of Christ. Let us celebrate. Walk you around the church, but I think you want to be with your family. In a Sunday school, you're welcome to make your way down to Sunday school if you like. And let us join together in singing Like a Healing Stream.
Today's Minute for Mission is the Church in China. Our gifts for mission and service support global partnership and theological engagement. Let us hear the story of the United Church delegation to the Church in China. We give thanks that the United Church of Canada answered an invitation from mission and service partner, the China Christian Council, to witness together and accompany one another in God's mission. The group of 22 United Church people from across Canada saw firsthand the experience of the Chinese church. Moderator Jordan Cantwell led the delegation. This visit opens a window for deepened church-to-church engagement and presents an opportunity for the United Church to understand China through encounters with Chinese Christians. The visit also recognized the existing partnership between our churches, building on a long history of mission and ministry together in China. It was another step in continuing our faithful journeys towards unity, justice, and peace. Delegates saw the blessings of the church in China and the challenges it is addressing. They shared from their unique perspective the challenges and opportunities of the United Church. We return with friendship and blessing of the Chinese Church and a deepened commitment to sharing God's great works in our diverse and varied Canadian contexts, said participant Betsy Anderson. We sing thanksgiving that mission and service helps build relationship and partnership for God's mission of justice and peace. If mission and service is already a regular part of your giving, thank you so much. If you have not given for mission and service, please join us in making mission and service a regular part of your life of faith. In all our mission and service giving, with a willing heart, we sing thanksgiving to God. And we're going to do Open Our Hearts from More Voices 21. Today's reading comes from Matthew 17, verses 1 to 9. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them high up a mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here for you. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my Son, the Beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." Herein lies good news.
Each February for the last 9 years, I've made a pilgrimage. I've journeyed down to be with a group of other men for a male spirituality circle. This group was held for over 30 years at Five Oaks, and this year made a new home at Creek Hills. It is an amazing and emotionally exhausting time. The 4 days include drumming, that's where I learned to drum, hymn singing, and time to walk, rest, and have individual conversations. But at the heart of the time shared together is something called the sharing circle. We sit together in a circle. In the middle of the circle, there's a table, and on that table is a stone, the grandfather's stone. And when someone wishes to speak and share something about themselves, they pick up the stone and talk. Everyone else simply listens. When he is done, he puts the stone back. Then when someone else wants to speak, they pick up the stone and talk. We don't respond to each other. We don't try to solve each other's problem. We just listen with love. We listen with love. In that circle, people have laughed. They've cried. They've cursed. They've shared heartbreak. And things that they've never spoken before. The fullness of our lives are set out into that circle, and it is held in love, care, and community. And it is a deeply holy and healing time. Today we hear the traditional Sunday before Lent begins reading of Jesus' transfiguration. It's a powerful and deeply symbolic story. Jesus takes three of his disciples up to a mountain, Peter, James, and John. Now in the Bible, mountains represent the place where the divine realm and the human realm meet. Whenever you hear the Bible or read, "They went to a mountain," it's a little clue saying, pay attention, something holy is about to happen. It is in this holy place that the disciples see Elijah and Moses standing with Jesus and hear the words that were spoken at Jesus' baptism. "This is my child, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." This rich story is about who Jesus is. Prophetic words from the Old Testament declared that before the Messiah arrives, in the fullness of time, Elijah would show up. We have the presence of Moses and Elijah. Moses, the one who gives the laws of God, the practices to help people be in harmony with the divine and with one another. And Elijah, the prophetic presence the holy voice that calls people to holy relationship with God and with neighbors through lives of love and justice. It's such a profound and holy moment that in the story, Peter declares, let us build some dwelling places, let us stay here just a while longer. But the moment fades, like most moments of awe, like a firework, it shines brightly for a moment and then fades away. But there's also another piece of this tale. Before and after this mountaintop moment in the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus talks about how he's going to be killed. It's not a surprise. He has said some pretty bold things about love and about justice and stood up to the powerful people. It's inevitable. Down the mountain is the road that will lead to confrontation, to an execution, to suffering, to death. This mountaintop moment, this transfiguration blessing, contains the fullness of time and the fullness of life, with all of its hopes and fears, longings and realizations, awe-filled moments and awful moments, life and death, justice and suffering. What an honor. What an honor we have today to share as a community as we mark Emmy's life as blessed and beautiful through our ritual of baptism. New life is holy. It's a holy moment. And that is why in our tradition, we honor it with the baptism of babies. Baptism reminds us of the sacredness and the goodness of life. With water and oil, we mark Emmy's life. And remember that all life is beautiful and blessed, as is held in God's love and the love near to the end of our service today. We will be taking part in another ancient ritual of our faith, another embodied ritual. It too honors and blesses the fullness of life, the marking of the ashes. Traditionally, this practice is held on the first day of Lent, Ash Wednesday. But instead, today we're going to share it as a full community. Ashes are a rich symbol that can be found throughout the world. Robert Bly, in his great book, Iron John, a book about men, speaks about the powerful symbol of ashes. He points out that the symbol of ashes appears in many fairy tales. Fairy tales talk about life. They're more than just children's tales. Think about Cinderella. Cinderella's name means little cinder girl. She's the girl of the ashes. Ashes and cinders symbolize in many stories the burned out, depressed, out of it kind that the main character faces before they move into an adult life. Throughout the world, Bly points out, ancient cultures used ashes to ritually symbolize the death of the childhood life and the birth into an adult life, a life of community and giving and sharing. Life that included suffering, letting go, death. Ashes appear throughout our Bible. Job covers himself in ashes when he faces the full suffering of life. Jonah and other prophets instruct people to tear their clothes and sit and cover themselves in ashes in those times where people are living out of tune with God, and this is resulting in great injustice and suffering. Ashes symbolize a movement from the idealized to the real, a movement into the fullness of life, where alongside the blessings and joys, there is also suffering, injustice, pain, death, lost hopes and dreams. I think most of us, not all of us, know what it is like to sit in the ashy places of life, to look around and see ashy moments around us. The adult life and the adult faith include both the water and oil of blessing and the ashes. When I was living in Northern Ontario, I learned the power of burned out places. How many of you have ever been to a place where there's been a forest fire? Some of us. They're devastating things. I learned the power of burned out places up there. One dry spring, a fire broke out beside the main highway that my wife and I drove but once a month. The earth was sooty, blackened, and dead trees stood. The air held on to that charcoal smell that filled the car for a long time afterwards. But then, in a time shorter than I thought it would take, I started seeing the green emerging, new life returning to the burned out places. The thing about forest fires is the ashes feed the new life. There's life on the other side of the ashes. Cinderella finds life after the burned out place of death of her mother and the cruelty of her stepfamily. Job finds life after the ashes. Children moved through the ash initiations into adulthood, a place of community that can hold both life's joys and sorrows, beginnings and endings. Our life includes mountaintop moments and descents into suffering, unjust places in life. It includes crosses and resurrections, life and death, water and ash. And when we learn not to be afraid, we learn not to be afraid or to hide away from the fullness of life, we can look around and see something deeply sacred. We can look around and see that we are never We are held and we are supported by the love of God who speaks the words, "You are my child, my beloved." We hear the sacred words, "Don't be afraid, get up." We are held in the love of community, a community that can laugh and smile, cry and curse, listen and love us as we offer one another strength to live and face that life brings. The fullness of life is blessed, is held in holy love. What a blessing we have today to be able to gather together as we share in scripture and take part in holy rituals that honor all that life brings. What a blessing to touch life-giving water and burned out ash, and to look around and to see that we are not alone, that we are held and strengthened in the love of God that is known in community. May we always remember that our whole life is held within holy love, and that the path of life we walk is met with kindness, love, support, and others. Journey with us. This is good news. Let it be so.
Spirit, open my heart. Invite you to join with me in singing hymn number 79 in Voices United. Will also be on the screen.
It's more voices.
Oh, more voices. Sorry. More voices. Number 79. It's more voices. Thank you. In response to the blessings of God that fill our life and that are found in community, we are invited to celebrate the gifts that fill our lives and to share our gifts of time, talent, love, relationship, and money. Let us celebrate and share. In a moment, we're invited to come to the front and receive the mark of the cross in oil and ash, a symbol of the love that holds us, a blessing for our journey into Lent and into the fullness of life. If you would prefer not to come up and would like to receive the anointing of the ashes and oil in your pew, after others are served, I invite you just to raise your hand when I ask and we'll come to you. If you'd prefer to receive The ashes and oil are traditionally put on the forehead. If you prefer to receive them on your hand, just indicate by pointing to your hand as you come forward. As with all rituals in our church, everyone is welcome, but no one is obliged to take part. After, there are paper towels, just as a cleanup note, there are paper towels at the back there if you do want to clean yourself before you go out. There's also wet wipes and paper towels outside the kitchen. We mix ashes and oil together. The ashes are burned palm branches from Palm Sunday services. We mix them together. We remember the traditional words of Ash Wednesday: we are born of dust, and to dust we will return. And this is not a curse, because our earthiness is not a curse. It's a blessing. Our bodies are a blessing. Our life, our relationships are a blessing. For while we may die, for now we live, and we are part of the beautiful and sacred creation.
Like Earth and Sonia,